Greetings. I'm sure we have all been looking forward to the return of the Lord, the bridegroom coming for his bride. I made a series about why I expect the rapture years ago, and my expectation has not changed since then. At least to me, it seems obvious that we are in the beginning of the birth pains. So maybe it's time I get off my lazy behind and rigorously review the related scriptures in a video series. Let's begin in Matthew and try to harmonize from there. Matthew 24:1. Jesus left the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up to him to call his attention to its buildings. Solomon's Temple, on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, must have been a very impressive sight to see. The Temple Mount was an important historical site for the Jewish people. This is one reason for Satan's aggressive agenda to destroy the historical record. Satan's agenda is implemented by Islam, striving over the centuries to claim the Temple Mount for Islam, even building the Dome of Damnation. Yet the city of Jerusalem is never mentioned in the Quran by name. See how easy it is to get derailed? There are just so many topics that must be addressed. Back on topic, the disciples were impressed with the temple structure, and Jesus is about to take this opportunity to shake their world. "Do you see all these things?" he asked. Jesus has their attention now. "Truly, I tell you, not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." Imagine their shock and the chaos in their minds. When? Who? How? Why? As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. Their minds were still not past the chaos. When? Who? How? Why? "Tell us," they said. "When will this happen? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" We have to realize they asked three questions in their flurry of interest. When will this happen, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? It looks like two. However, this second question is compound because of the "and," so it is really two questions. What will be the sign of your coming, and three, what will be the sign of the end of the age? By asking it as one compound question, there is an implied assumption that the two nouns, or events, are tied together. Your coming and the end of the age. Surely, when Messiah comes, it is the end of this current age, right? Not necessarily, and don't call me surely. Jesus then answers, and we must consider the distinct possibility. He is answering three, and not only two, questions. When will this happen? What will be the sign of your coming? And what will be the sign of the end of the age? Jesus answered, "Watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many." Jesus warns of deception. Keep that in mind. This ties directly into 2 Thessalonians 2, but I don't want to jump there yet. "For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many." Years ago, I began a study of Matthew 24, and this verse totally derailed it. Essentially, the idea arose in me, perhaps by the Holy Spirit, that Islam's claim, Jesus is the Messiah, fits this described deception. The claim by Islam does deceive many weak Christians into thinking Islam does respect Jesus and his teachings. Following this initial warning of deception, Jesus begins to describe details. With each detail, consider which question it potentially answers. "You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come." Does this answer one, two, or three? It speaks of wars and rumors, but not his coming. He adds, "but the end." From that, I think it is approaching question three by talking about things before the end. But it could also be talking of the sacking of Jerusalem, the war by the Romans when the temple is destroyed. When will this, the destruction of the temple, happen? And what will be the sign of your coming? And what will be the sign of the end of the age? I believe he is answering one, but mentions three as well, saying, but the end is not yet. To paraphrase and hopefully clarify, when you see the temple destroyed, it is not yet the end of the age. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. I used to think this meant countries will be at war with other countries. But recently I heard someone teach that this was racial tension, and that the Greek word translated nation was ethnos. Always be a good Berean and check for yourself when you hear new information. Sure enough, looking in Strong's, the English word nation is a translation of ethnos. You can see it there. Will rise up for nation is ethnos to the left. Against nation is again ethnos to the left. Maybe this describes the rising racial violence. It does not need to account for who seeded it or fans the flames. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me. There are multiple reasons why Christians might be persecuted. They have high moral values. They stand against sodomy. They stand against theft. They reject Mohammedism. They represent the truth. And there is a new reason that has just been thrust on humanity. They will not comply with forced injections of dubious drugs. All of these things are being done by sincere Christians following Christ, and the world hates us for them. Are Christians the only people doing these things? No, some non-Christian people do some of these things for their own various reasons. But Christians will be hated for those reasons and more that arise from our faith in God, His covenant, His salvation, and more arising from following Christ. Like supporting Israel. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. The persecution and suffering will cause some, even many, to turn away from following the gospel. This dovetails, closely aligns, with the falling away described in 2 Thessalonians 2:3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Here the author repeats Jesus' warning against being deceived. Let no man deceive you by any means. In Paul's day, one deception was by a false letter, claiming that Jesus had already come. The day of the Lord had already happened. At that time, many will turn away from the faith. Many times, interpreting prophecy is a process of disqualification, rather than absolute proof. By this, I mean a proposed fulfillment might be disqualified from consideration, but failure to disqualify does not prove fulfillment. The whole prophecy must be applied, and at a minimum, the proposal must meet all elements of the prophecy to be considered. This is why Christians immediately reject claims of Muhammad fulfilling any prophecy in the Bible. Muhammad never meets the details of the prophecy, whichever one Mohammedans choose to misapply as credentials for Muhammad, save for this general statement in Matthew 24:11, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Without question, Muhammad is one of those. And Islam, as any kind of path to truth or God or salvation, is his and Satan's deception. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. The context here is very clear, as is the meaning, that many, not some, not a few, many will turn away, leave, abandon the faith. In the original Greek, will fall away is scandalous thesantai. I'm sure I butchered the Greek, but there it is. It's root derived from root 4624 scandalizo, to cause to stumble, to give offense. I cause to stumble, cause to sin, cause to become indignant, shock, offend. In these last days, Christians will leave the faith because something causes them to be offended about it. This is leaving the faith, not leaving the earth. This is not talking about rapture or Christians departing the earth. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Having left the faith, they will actually betray other Christians. Unfortunately, I am seeing division in the body of Christ. I was shocked when a Christian friend told me getting the jabs is a must or I am murdering people. Note to YouTube censors, I am not offering medical advice of any kind. I do not think this is the mark of the beast, but it is an early phase of preparing humanity to accept it. Suffice it to say, it is close enough to the fire that I do not wish to play with it or near it, lest I get singed. My opinions and my decisions are my own. My body, my choice. Every damned soundbite spewed to support the killing of babies surely applies with equal validity. Moving on. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. The rhetoric and hatred being spoken and shouted by global leaders should remind all of Nazi Germany and Hitler's bombast. More and more nations, even the state of Washington in the U.S., now have concentration camps for the non-submissive who refuse the jab. I specifically and precisely say concentration camps because they are concentrating the unjabbed into fenced, patrolled, policed prison camps. The propaganda and narrative is that such detention is temporary, but horror stories are coming from camps in other nations. I digress. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Again, some form of the word deceit, deception, deceive, comes across as a warning from the Son of God. Falsehoods, lies, cunningly devised fables, so-called narratives, propaganda. Everything you are hearing from the leftist media of the U.S. and the world, they repeat fables and narratives that are provably false. Because of the increase in wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. Guard your hearts. Stay in love with God, our Savior. Don't let your love grow cold. Long for His return. Guard against anger and hate with those who persecute you. I confess that is one of the biggest challenges I find myself facing. Anger at the lost. As a teacher, it offends me when people do not want to learn the truth or even discuss it rationally. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. Therefore, take up the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you will be able to stand your ground, and having done everything, to stand. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. This does not mean that the moment the gospel is taught in the last place on earth, the end instantly happens. It does mean the gospel will remain, persist, and be taught throughout the world. It has not been changed, twisted, lost, or corrupted as those spreading Muhammad's religion claim. This is getting long, so I will have to continue this series in part 2. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.